Ladies and gentlemen, our special session with Mr. Advani to make the opening statement. May I invite someone who has written extensively on events that have changed the political course of the nation and the people who've engineered them. He's won several awards for his work, and he is the editor of India Today and editorial director, India Today Group of Publications, Mr. Prabhu Chawla.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. First, I must apologize for following it some kind of a unconventional method of introducing the guest. And I seek advance apologies also. Advani ji, aapse bhi, ki main kuch dikhane ja raha hoon, uske liye main aapse chhama pehle maang leta hoon, kyunki jo bhi galti hui thi us wakat, wo politically incorrect thi. But still, I think what I thought was a mistake turned out to be truth. Now, I will request to just to play what we did with him in Sidi Bagh. Please. आपने पार्टी खड़ी की किसे साथ जैसे उस दिन कहा बाउन से आप इलेक्शन लड़ाना चाह रहे हैं तो लगता नहीं कि आपका रोल भी मजाक में बोले कि आप हमेशा बराती के रोल में खुश हैं कभी दूल्हा बनने की भी कोशिश की आपको लगता है तमन्ना आपने बड़ी कड़ी दफना दी क्या
कोई हमारे इस रोल को अगर बराती का रोल समझेगा तो मैं उनके विचार पर ही दया करूंगा और कुछ नहीं करूंगा
मैं क्योंकि बरात को तैयार करने में जो आपका रोल रहता है जो बड़े घर के लोगों का होता है तो दूल्हा बनने की इमेज भी कभी ख्वाहिश होती है ना
मैं समझता हूँ आज भगवान ने जो मुझे दायित्व दिया है मैंने तो कभी सोचा नहीं था इट इज समथिंग फार बियॉन्ड माय इमेजिनेशन एंड आई हैव इफ आई हैव हैड एनी एम्बिशन एंड एस्पिरेशन इट हैज बीन दैट माय भारतीय जनता पार्टी एंड द संघ परिवार टू विच आई बिलोंग शुड बी डिसाइडिंग द डेस्टिनीज ऑफ द कंट्री एंड दिस इज समथिंग दैट आई हैव बीन एबल टू अचीव टू सम
As all of us know, that Mr. Advani is responsible for what the BJP is today. It was in that context, when he was answering questions, that he has been a part of the party for the past 50 years, and he has been responsible for raising the strength of the BJP from just two MPs in 1984 to about 190 in 1998. You always been a barati. But will you ever become a bridegroom? You were a little angry at that time, I can see. Because being a person like me who can't be different than Prabhu Chawla, so I did ask him this question. It was, of course, mixed metaphor kind of a thing. The famous quotation of Citizen Kane's Friend is a famous film, where he said that I will always be the bridegroom's maid, but never the bridegroom. Here is the bridegroom now. Let's welcome L.K. Advani once again as one of the speakers. Advani is not new to our regular delegates. He is the one politician who has been witness to the many twists and turns that Indian politics has seen. His many reflections can be found in his book, My Country, My Life, which is being released next week. Advani ji, ladies and gentlemen, the topic of this session poses a pertinent question. How does the BJP's leadership differ from that of the Congress? That's the question he is going to answer. Kya ye dula? NDA ne jinko announce kiya hai? क्या ये सबसे अलग है इफ दिस ब्राइडग्रूम पॉलिटिकल ब्राइडग्रूम इज डिफरेंट देन ऑल अदर ब्राइडग्रूम्स अवेलेबल इन द पॉलिटिकल मार्केट दैट्स द क्वेश्चन वी हैव टू एड्रेस इज द बरात विच इज बिहाइंड हिम इज इट डिफरेंट देन द रेस्ट ऑफ द बरात बिकॉज़ देयर आर सो मेनी पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज इन दिस कंट्री दैट्स द क्वेश्चन वी हैव टू आंसर दिस लीडरशिप हाउ इट इज डिफरेंट देन द मोस्ट ऑफ द अदर लीडरशिप विच वी ऑल सीक टू वोट फॉर द क्वेश्चन इज पर्टिनेंट मिस्टर अडवाणी बिकॉज ऑफ लेट the culture of Congressism has been seeping into your parivar as well. The party with a difference, as your opposition would accuse you, is accusing you now, the party with a difference is now perceived to be the party with many differences. We saw suddenly qualities like leader fetish and fear of the dissent on the right side of the political divide as well. The history of the BJP is one of both struggle and romance. Born out of wreckage of Janata experiment, the party has to struggle to get mainstream acceptability. Let me remind you, it was none other than Advani who chose, I'm using this phrase again, who chose flirtatious political adventurism. He had a political romance. It was his idea of a political romance in 1988 when he had a romance, political romance of course, if you misunderstood, political romance with Jayalalitha, with Mayawati, with Mamata, and that's why, because of that political romance, Atal Bihari Vajpayee became the Prime Minister in 1998. India has never seen before such an ideological churning. It heralded the rise of new political establishment. It was not without any reason that the BJP was called a party with a difference. The difference was, of course, most visible in its leadership. Or should I say, it was the leadership that made the difference. In the Congress, it is the dynastic impulses that define the leadership. In the BJP, the leadership is not absolute, despite the two aces, Atal and Advani. The differences are cultural and institutional. Still, questions remain. Is the BJP right enough in playing out its economic script? Is its cultural agenda inclusive enough? Is its worldview true to its ideological core? To answer these questions and to enlighten us on fundamental differences in leadership, there is no one more qualified than our distinguished speaker, Mr. Lal Krishan Advani. Unlike most politicians, for Advani, conviction is not a matter of convenience. Can you imagine anyone with an image that Advani had of a hardline Hindutvavadi, stirring up the debate on Jinnah's secular credential? It was indeed a Shakespearean tragedy. In crowning Jinnah as a secular messiah, Advani lost his own crown. He was betrayed by his own very men. He was down, but never out. Finally, the idea of Advani won, and he was anointed the king by those who led the very revolt against him. It is his greatness that he still trusts them and in their wisdom. He believes in what Mr. Chalmers once said, it is written there, success is not final, failure is not fatal. He survived that what might have been great political tragedy. After all, as the first Yatri of Indian politics, he traveled the most, labored the most for bringing the BJP back to power. As a political leader who has participated as a campaigner or a candidate in every general election since 1952, he is the last of the titans we have in our politics today. Advani was the power that secured the throne and protected it from both internal and external aggressions. Advani is the man who added few words to the political dictionary of India, like pseudo-secularism, cultural nationalism, and the last one, criminalization of politics. People use the criminalization of politics. What he meant by criminalization of politics, the control of left over the UPA government. That is what he got. He is a Mahan Shakti who looms over the Indian right. A Rath Yatri in search of Hindutva's most political rewarding destination, the Prime Ministership of India. An inventor of new political art of winning hearts. That is, the man who has brought the displaced Hindu gods to the polling booths of India. A cultural nationalist who rages against pseudo-secularists. For so long, Advani, the long-distance traveler of Indian right, one of its twin towers, Atal and Advani. Today, the other is gracefully retired. Advani is in singular splendor. Ladies and gentlemen, he could be our next Prime Minister. And I am sure he could be the Prime Minister with a difference. I say this because he has some serious differences with the current Prime Minister. He calls him the weakest Prime Minister the country ever had. He has the gut to say that. Next week you can buy his memoirs to know him better. I had known him for 40 years, but I must confess that after going through an advanced copy of his book, I have a better idea of the man and his mind, of the sweep of his intellect and the depth of his convictions. As an idealist and an activist, as a dissenter and as a prisoner, as a parliamentarian and a mobilizer, as a nationalist, he has been a life lived in full. He ends his memoir in an optimistic note. I quote, "I have performed every responsibility, minor or major, that has been entrusted to me from time to time in the course of my long political journey with honesty, devotion and commitment. This accounts for the credibility I have earned in public life. In future too, I shall perform any duty that destiny may assign to me with the same aspiration," unquote. But will he perform? Can he stop the Congressitaran of his party? Can he tame the gen next? Can he make the party the different again? Does he have an economic philosophy of his own? Can he tame the ambitious second generation leaders? Is Advani ahead of that? Advani ji, today there seems to be an audacious alignment of destiny and destination. Today, political bridegroom is also get on the horse again. Sawal uthta hai, kya is rajnitik swayambar mein dulhan is naye var ko varmala pehnayegi? Iska jawab khud wari dhenge. Main unko request karunga ki aakar ke ek bar fir se hamare ko he must address us and give his point of view on this. Thank you very much.
Prabhuji, it's always a delight participating in India Today conclaves. This is the second time that I have come here. But I must say at the outset that I wasn't very comfortable with the subject that you chose for me today. और आपने अभी अभी बहुत बार दूल्हा ब्राइड ग्रूम ये सब जो कहा है और कहा है कि मैं ब्राइड ग्रूम बनने वाला हूं या बन गया हूं तो आप अगर ब्राइड ग्रूम से ही गुणों के बारे में पूछने लगे तो उनको कैसा लगेगा दो आई बिलीव दैट इफ द क्वेश्चन हैड बीन a kind of a comparison between the BJP and the Congress, that would not have been uncomfortable. But to say that how the BJP's leadership differs from that of the Congress, if you had asked me how the economic vision, perspective of the BJP differs from that of the Congress, how does your party's approach to the problems of security differ from those of the Congress? And all such questions which you have in the course of your introduction mentioned, that would not have been a problem at all. But when you talk of leadership of the two parties, and that too in the context of my having been named the leader of the party for the next elections, therefore I did not feel unhappy that you had started with your Seedhi Baat. I thought that would make it even more clear why the question posed to me is somewhat uncomfortable. But I can tell you that it's not merely my party, but parties which have a leadership which doesn't belong to the pre-1947 period. Unka problem hai ek. Here in India, politics has been somewhat different from what it has been in other democracies of the world. Here in India, prior to 1947, politics was not an occupation, was not a profession. It was a mission. It was related to the fact that India was under foreign yoke. And those who came to public life were inspired mainly by this desire to liberate the country from foreign thraldom. And that motivated everyone. After 1947, what has happened? We've seen before our own eyes the kind of degeneration that has crept into politics. I'll talk about it later, but at the moment, I would only say that I would not deny that leadership is a very important factor. And so, if we talk about leadership, it's a very important facet of politics and political parties. If someone else had been chosen, I'm sure, or it could have been very well expressed. Today, when I look at it, I would say that the first and foremost difference between the Congress Party and the BJP, so far as leadership is concerned, is what you yourself have in a way indicated, that this is a democratic party in which the persons who come to the post of leader or leadership, they are from the common people who support that party. It's not dynastic leadership. That's the first and foremost difference between the Congress and the BJP leadership. In the Congress party, leadership, there is reservation for members of a particular dynasty at the top slot. No one else can. Gradually it has come to that. And I sometimes feel depressed to see how brazenly an entire party has been appropriated and made into a family fiefdom. And how slavishly congressmen have resigned themselves to this appropriation. It is one of the saddest developments of Indian political evolution. It could not have been thought of in the early years, could not have been. But gradually it is accepted. I remember during the emergency, there used to be a lot of debate on the issue of basic structure of the constitution. And how the then Congress expressed its unhappiness with the Keshavanand Bharati judgment, which said that Parliament can amend any provision of the Constitution, but no amendment could be of a nature which undermines the basic structure of the Constitution. And that basic structure is democracy. That basic structure is secularism. That basic structure is independence of the judiciary and all such facets of the Constitution. And they said that these basic structures cannot be altered. It was altered during the emergency. And our biggest quarrel during the emergency was that how can you undermine a constitution in this manner as you have done by the 42nd Amendment? We were behind bars at that time. My senior colleague Vajpayee ji, a person like Jai Prakash Narayan, a person like Murarji Desai, a person like Chandra Shekhar, patriots of the highest order, and all of them put behind bars because you are a threat to nation security. And the constitution is amendment to provide that so-and-so, the prime minister, the president of the country, the vice president of the country, and such three or four leaders of the government, they can never be tried for anything. Any offense they may have committed in the past or any offense they may commit in the future, there can be no trial, they cannot be taken to task. England mein to khali itna hi kaha, the queen can do no wrong, the king can do no wrong. Yahan to the president, the vice president, the prime minister, they can never do any wrong. It was amazing. And all this was sought to be done in a constitutional manner. Basic structure altered here. I want to tell you that today, without formally changing the constitution of the Congress party, they have destroyed the basic structure of the Congress constitution. Who could conceive this? And it's not surprising that those who have the arrogance to tamper with the nation's constitution for the sake of power, tampering with the tradition of leadership selection within one's own party is a very small matter indeed for them. How can they be bothered about it? But the country which believes in democracy should be bothered about it, should be concerned about it. So far as the BJP is concerned, we have before us role models like Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, starting with him, an eminent educationist, a person who had been in public life before he launched the Janasangha, because my political yatra, as well as of those of my colleagues in the BJP, started not with the BJP in 1980, but it actually started with the Janasangha in 1951. And such an eminent person that even though the first cabinet of Pandit Nehru of independent India was presumed to be a Congress cabinet, and Dr. Mukherjee and Dr. Ambedkar both were lifelong critics of the Congress party, it was Mahatma Gandhi who advised Pandit Nehru to include these two luminaries in his cabinet. And they were included. And his performance as the first industries minister of independent India was outstanding. I'm referring to this because he started the Janasangha because he differed with his prime minister on the question of handling of East Pakistan, and said, it's our commitment to the Hindus of East Pakistan that even after partition, their rights would be safeguarded. He differed with Pandit Nehru on the issue of Kashmir. These were the two main differences he had with Kashmir, with Pandit Nehru. And he quit the government. He quit the government and launched the Bharatiya Janasangha shortly before the first general elections came. And many of us, we have been associated with that party since then. What a parliamentarian he was. I saw him only from the press gallery at that time. I was myself working in Rajasthan. And I am always reminded that in the first parliament of independent India, there were two Mukherjees who were the best speakers. Outstanding. One was Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, and the other was Hiren Mukherjee. One belonging to the party which I have had the privilege of belonging, and the other belonging to the CPI. And since then, I have had great admiration and respect for Hiren Mukherjee. Not merely because of his oratorical skills, but because of his conviction, his commitment, and the fact that despite his association with the CPI, he always stood out as an outstanding patriot. And I remember once when there was the question of whom to set up as the opposition candidate for presidency. And in the all-party meeting, his name was proposed, Hiren Mukherjee's name. I, on behalf of the Janasangh, I said, I readily accept it. I have no objection. Everyone was surprised. Ki kya ho gaya? And within my own party, some people did complain. Hey, what happened to Advani? That he's accepting a CPI man as a candidate for presidency. I did accept. I knew him personally and I highly respected him. Of course, it's a different matter that when his nominations were to be filed, it was found that his name was not in the electoral roll. So he could not be nominated. And then the all-party meeting stood again, where I proposed the name of Justice Khanna. And his name was accepted. Everyone accepted his name. But this is incidental, that Dr. Shama Prasad Mukherjee and Hiren Mukherjee was the best speakers in that Lok Sabha. What is more important is that in the first plenary session of the Bharatiya Janasangha at Kanpur in 1953, he identified that in this situation, when India has been partitioned, and what remains of India, it is our duty to see that it becomes united, integrated, as one piece. And it is not what very many scholars have always addressed India as, that it is a conglomeration of several nations. It's a conglomeration, all that. It's one nation. And that nation is there. So let us strengthen that concept. The constitution makers, even while deciding about federalism, tried to strengthen that. I can quote Dr. Ambedkar, when he said that why we have called it a union of states, in which he says that even though we have called it a union of states, we regard this country as one country. And therefore it is that for changing the boundaries of a state, Article 3 provides that this will not be an amendment of the constitution. It will need a simple majority. And States Reorganization Commission, or the states that we created when we were in power, or the various states that have been created in the Northeast, these have been created without changing the constitution as such. It's because we believe that India is one nation. And at that time, Dr. Mukherjee said, if India is one nation, how come that I cannot go to Jammu and Kashmir? I cannot go there without a permit? How come that the tricolor can fly in New Delhi, but the tricolor cannot fly beyond Pathankot? In Jammu and Kashmir, it cannot fly? How come that the Indian president has no authority over Jammu and Kashmir? How come that the Supreme Court has no authority over Jammu and Kashmir? How come that the Controller and Auditor General, the Election Commission, they have no authority over Jammu and Kashmir? And he gave a resounding slogan to the country and to the party workers. He said, Ek desh mein do vidhan, ek desh mein do pradhan, ek desh mein do nishan, nahi chalenge, nahi chalenge. And not only gave that slogan, but called upon the session there, plenary session, all of us, let us undertake our first agitation in independent India on this issue for the sake of Jammu Kashmir's complete integration with India. And he led that agitation. He crossed the Pathankot bridge without a permit. The policemen arrested him there. He was imprisoned, and he was not just incarcerated. He paid with his own life. He died in prison. It's only after that that the permit system was abolished. It's only after that that the president's authority, the election commission's authority, the Supreme Court's authority, the authority of the Comptroller and Auditor General of India, they were all extended to Jammu and Kashmir. For the first time, the tricolor flew in Jammu and Kashmir after his martyrdom. I remember only last year I had occasion to reenact that entire story and hold a rally just beyond Pathankot Bridge across the border to Jammu and Kashmir, where I remember honoring a widow who had died whose husband had died hoisting a tricolor at that place, and he had been shot dead by the police of Jammu and Kashmir police. That how dare you hoist a tricolor here? This is the beginning. This is the kind of leader who has been our first role model. And immediately after that came a person whom I have always held, even in the book that has been referred to by Prabhu. If I have said that if there is any person who has influenced my thinking, my nature, my life the most, it is Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay. Never ever aspired for power. Not just power, but he would shun his name appearing in the newspapers. He would avoid that. I used to be a journalist those days when I first came in contact with him. I used to be in the News Weekly organizer, and he used to write a political diary for us every week. It used to deal with some of the other topical subject. One day I said to him, I said, Panditji, you call this a political diary. It's very well written. It's very popular with the readers. But suppose, for instance, you make it a diary. Suppose, for instance, after all, you travel so much and you meet so much, people so much, you interact with so many people in the country. If you were to write a diary, its readability would increase considerably. So, as a journalist myself, I thought, if he were to write that, what? He said, he slightly said, mujhe theek nahi lagta. I pressed it. He said, all right, I'll try it. And he wrote two pieces. He had gone to the Agra University to address them. He had interaction with the Vice Chancellor there. He wrote about that. And one more. And again, then he spoke to me. He said, Lal mujhse nahi hota. Main nahi bol sakta. No other reason I could understand except that he did not like writing about himself. I have written about myself just now, the book that I have written. He was a remarkable person, outstanding really, both in terms of intellectual ability, in terms of character, in terms of his dedication, and in terms of his ability to mobilize cadres for the party and inspire them and promote them. And of course, the third person all of you know, who I would say has been the third role model for our party cadres, a person who led a coalition comprising at one point of time nearly 24 political parties, and such a stable manner, 6 years. Shuru mein humko sandeh lagta tha. He spoke about my romancing with this and that and all that. I'll come to that also, because I believe that the BJP's achievement today has been because of several factors. The ability to identify the right agenda for discussion. Second factor, from the very beginning, consciously to demolish the hegemony of the Congress Party. The kind of hegemony the Congress Party has enjoyed for nearly 4.5 decades, we destroyed it, and consciously destroyed it. Not many of you may be aware that he talked about my alliance with the ADMK or with BSP or with Trinamool. But it was in 1967 that my party had an alliance with the Communist Party. And even before that, in 1958, in the Corporation of Delhi, we had an alliance with the Communist Party. And I have mentioned all this. In 1967, when we had an alliance with the Communist Party, and SVD governments were formed in Bihar, in Madhya Pradesh, in Uttar Pradesh. SVD would mean Sanyukt Vidhayak Dal. The SVD government in Bihar, as well as the one in Punjab, had a communist member also. And immediately after that, in 1967, December, we had a plenary session of the party in Calicut, in Kerala. The first time that we had a conference in Calicut. And Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay, who for all these years, even though he was the leader of the party in all respects, he never accepted to be president. He was persuaded to become president that year. He became president. And in that debate, there were members of the party who attacked Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay. What have you done? Communist ke sath samjhota kar liya. I remember an outstanding speaker from Punjab. I always remember him. He was one of the public speakers those days, much in demand by the party units. His name was Vishwanathan. He was from Kerala, but his family had settled in Ludhiana. And Vishwanathan spoke that day. And he said, what have you done, Pandit ji? Samjhota kar liya inke saath, communisto ke saath. Do we think that we are going to change them? Never forget, there is a famous saying in Hindi, ki chakku kharbuje par gire ya kharbuja chakku par gire, katega to kharbuja. And that debate was a very good debate. But even more outstanding and unforgettable was Deen Dayal ji's reply to that entire debate. The essential part of it was something that we have imbibed forever. He said in his reply, apart from say other things, he said, I find it odd that while in social life, untouchability is supposed to be evil. In politics, if you do not practice untouchability in respect of this party, that party, that party, then you are supposed to be wrong. And he said, so far as Janasangh is concerned, my advice to all would be, never think in terms of any party participating in democracy as untouchable. You may not join hands with it, but there can be occasions when you two can work together. There can be occasions. And if for the sake of destroying the hegemony of the Congress, you come together, there's nothing wrong in it. Come together. All right. Doesn't matter. That's as far back as in 1967, this was the advice he gave us. And I remember very often this particular advice. I remember when our government was formed in 98, Vajpayee ji became the Prime Minister. I was declared the Home Minister. That very evening, Vajpayee ji phones to me, said, Advani ji, Keral ki khabar mili? Maine kaha, kya khabar? To unhone kaha ki comrade EMS Nambudri Pad has passed away. I said, acha. And he said, do you think at tomorrow's funeral and the all-party meeting that has been organized in Thiruvananthapuram, the government should be represented? I said, it certainly should be represented. He was an outstanding leader, outstanding person, and a person who devoted all his life to the welfare of the nation as he believed in it. He was a severe critic of ours. And I said to Vajpayee ji, if you think it's right, I can myself go. I'll go today to Thiruvananthapuram. He said, bahut acha hoga. And so my first official duty as Home Minister of the country was to go to Thiruvananthapuram to pay homage to EMS Nambudri Pad, a severe critic of the Janasangh, of the RSS, of the BJP, everyone. Always. That's my first duty that I performed. And there, speaking at that all-party meeting, I always recall what I said. I said, people may not be aware, but I would like to point out that about the same time that EMS Nambudri Pad was the Secretary General of the Malabar Congress, I was talking of the pre-1947 period, about the same time that EMS Nambudri Pad was General Secretary of the Malabar Congress, the person who has inspired me since my childhood, Dr. Keshav Baliram Hedgewar, the founder of the RSS, he was the General Secretary of the Vidarbha Congress about the same time. Both of them belonging to different ideologies. For them, Congress was only a platform through which the war against the British ruler was to be waged. And they waged it in their own respective manner, with their own respective beliefs. But it was idealism that brought them together. Idealism that India must be a free country. India must be liberated from foreign rule. I have no difficulty with that. I have mentioned all this because I believe that Dr. Mukherjee and Deen Dayal Upadhyay and Atal Bihari Vajpayee are, for all political leaders, for all political parties, exemplars as to what kind of politics we should have. And they did not belong to any big family, any great, they did not have any such inheritance that brought them to that position. They came up to that place by virtue of their service, by virtue of their understanding of issues. I was personally so flabbergasted by Atalji's oratory when I heard him for the first time, that for a long time I could not get over the complex that I developed. I was in Rajasthan those days, and he had come there, and I traveled with him throughout the... he would hold the audience spellbound with his speech. And even the most difficult concepts, he could explain to them with wit and humor in a manner that made me feel ki main to kahan kuch nahi kar sakunga ki kahan Atalji. Aur phir when he tried to persuade me to become the president of the party in 1973, maine kaha mujhse nahi hoga, main nahi kar sakta. Maine kaha parliament mein to bolte ho, maine kaha parliament mein bolna ek cheez hai aur hazaron logon ke beech mein bolna, आप जिस प्रकार से बोलते हैं मैं तो नहीं बोल सकता, सवाल ही नहीं. एंड सच लीडर्स ऑफ द पार्टी वी हैव हैड, एंड बिकॉज ऑफ देम देयर हैज बीन वेरी ऑफन दे से जनरेशन नेक्स्ट, यंगर जनरेशन, ये वो, बहुत अच्छा है. हमारे यहां तो इतने लोग हो गए कि एक एक अपने अपने स्टेट में जब वो बन गए, अपने मुख्यमंत्री बन गए, कोई कुछ बन गया, कोई all of them have acquitted themselves very well. But the most important factor is honesty, credibility. And that factor we have tried to build into the cadres, into the workers, into the office bearers, to the best extent that we have, we can. Ki bhai, galti ho sakti hai, galti ho jaye, स्वीकार कर लेनी चाहिए, करेक्ट कर लेनी चाहिए. और इन्होंने बात कही अपने क्रिमिनलाइजेशन की, और ही फेल्ट दैट मैंने क्रिमिनलाइजेशन इसको कहा कि कम्युनिस्ट पार्टी का उन पर प्रभाव हो गया है. नो, द वर्ड क्रिमिनलाइजेशन आई यूज इन अ डिफरेंट कॉन्टेक्स्ट व्हेन आई क्रिटिसाइज द प्रेजेंट प्राइम मिनिस्टर. आई सेड it's only in Soviet Russia, when it was under Marxist rule, that this kind of situation prevailed. I used to be in Rajasthan those days when Bulganin and Khrushchev had come to Jaipur for the first time. They had come to India for the first time. And in those days, I was a journalist myself. And so, I came to know about the controversy that arose in respect of protocol. Who is to be given primacy between Khrushchev and Gorbachev? And the USSR insisted. They said, we are not concerned with what you in India believe in. But for us, it is the first secretary of the Communist Party who comes first, not the president of the USSR. And the government had to accept. They could not say anything more.